You're watching Soul Sisters on Pure Soul, powered by Isaac Hayes on Dash Radio. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having
you
me.
You look beautiful.
Thank you.
Look at you. We matching, y'all. We both got blue on. Heather didn't get the memo.
My clothes are in boxes right now, so don't talk to me.
We're going to give you a pass.
Please.
We're going to give you a pass
okay,
today.
Okay, rough weekend.
After that story. Oh, my goodness.
God. I missed the story.
Oh, but awful. You should have been in here calming me down like.
Right.
Heather had an
experience
yes.
this weekend with the movers that didn't go
that
so
later.
Well.
Yes.
Yes.
And you can teach me how to chant and get my mind back together. Where have you been?
I have been well.
So I'll just say that I love Soleil. I haven't seen her in 20 years, but I had the pleasure of working for her, watching her record, I think, one of her first album,
yes.
singing a little background on it and dancing, went to L.A. with you.
Mm-hmm.
And it is just so good to see
it's
you.
It's good to see you. It's been a long time.
Yes.
And you look exactly the same.
So do like you.
You haven't aged.
So do you.
Thank you.
So do you. And you got new music, I video do. And all that coming up. So clearly it's been a shift.
Yes. A big
show. So I know that when you were here, you left and you moved to LA, correct?
No, I actually moved to DC.
Oh, that's right.
Maryland. So I was living in Maryland.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
She's from Baltimore.
Did you? Okay. Yeah. So I was living in Maryland outside. I was closer to DC.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. I went to University of Maryland, College Park, undergrad. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh. So that's when we kind of lost touch. I didn't see you anymore. You moved to Maryland. So how did you get from the Soleil that I remember, just that, you know.
I'm scared
which
of
was
the Soleil
still,
you remember.
No.
Oh, my goodness.
Funny, this is a funny thing to me. Because
it's progression.
Yeah,
it is.
But,
she,
but
it
the thing about it is what I will say is you were nothing but sweet, kind, nice, hard worker. Oh. Nothing negative. There's
Thank
nothing anybody
you.
Could ever say in my
Thank
experience.
You.
Like,
yeah.
that's, you know. And me and my brother were around you a lot at
yeah.
that point. So there was just... You know,
yeah.
so I'm sure everybody is progression and growth and people
right.
change and things like
right.
that. Obviously you have, you know, because of life experiences and your perspectives,
right.
you know, and your beliefs might change. But the core of who you were even back then, beautiful person.
Thank you.
Inside and out. So that's
Thank
just.
You. I appreciate
so how do we get from, you know, because I know we've had marriages and babies
yeah.
and marriages again. So how
yeah.
do we get from point A to point B?
You I'll give it. You the short end.
Okay.
Yes.
The short of it. So I had the first album out, and I recorded the second album,
mm-hmm.
and I decided I didn't want to put it out. I
decided
wow. that the album was done. It was ready to go. They had sent the first single to some DJs. I don't know if it went to radio.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I was being conflicted then with myself, so I was feeling... a spiritual prompting, like, I don't want to do this in the way I'm doing it,
mm-hmm.
and I don't know any other way to do it, and I just don't want to do it at
yeah.
all. And so...
that was a huge risk, right?
Some people would say.
Yeah. I mean, in a good
mean,
way,
for,
but I'm just saying it was a huge risk to kind of step
yeah.
out like that.
Yeah, I literally had an experience, and I heard a spirit speaking to me saying... is this the example you want to be for your
mm-hmm.
children? And
mm-hmm.
it was like, no. And so I was like, okay, let me figure out how do I do this in another way? You know, I'm a hip hop artist, and I the time I came up, I came up with conscious hip hop, but then everything switched and it was real hardcore. And then I grew up hood and in the hood and and that was the music that I wrote, but I wrote stories. So really even the album, even though it was, I always joke and say it was littered with profanity, it still had some positive messages on it. But just the way I was presenting myself, the way I was being presented.
Yeah, but you're female in the industry, I'm pretty sure I know in the beginning you don't really have a lot of control
no.
as to how you're being presented.
Yeah,
and the funny
no.
thing is I think that, I mean, people were doing it, but... at that time, but I also felt like when I look back, you know, because there is definitely a shift.
Yeah.
I mean, it was profanity, but I also, even when I look back now, I'm like, but she was strong and opinionated. She had an opinion, and that mattered
yeah,
even
did.
At that point. And I love that about you. I love
Thank
that there
you.
Was you were unapologetic about the things that you had to say. Now, I totally understand you have children
right.
at that point, and the way you were saying it, maybe,
right, right.
you know, you felt like it needed to shift.
Yeah.
But I, you know, I think it's to each its own, but I just think that the messaging for some of us, especially adult women, it was strength.
Yeah.
And it, even though they didn't know behind the scenes, like people made them say, you got to dress like this, you got to do this, but it was a strong presentation to me.
Right.
You know, but the second album, so I didn't know that you just like, I don't want to put it out.
Yeah, I did. I was pregnant with my third daughter with Story. And I really just, I said, I want to be home. I want to be a mother. I want to be a better example. I want to grow. It was a prompting to get back to a spiritual grounding that I had when I was a child, even before religious indoctrinations, but this spirit and knowing that I had as a little child, and that started calling me again. And so I quit. I was like, I'm not putting it out. Like, and you know, like you said, if I didn't want to do something, I wasn't going to do it. And so Kasim Reed, who was the mayor of Atlanta, he wasn't the mayor then, was my attorney. He negotiated my record deal and my publishing deal. And then he also successfully negotiated me out of it, not owing anything. Oh. I walked away not owing a penny. So I didn't have to.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and then right? I saw him recently too at Slutty Vegan. I hadn't seen him in 20 years either.
Wow.
And yeah, I slipped into somewhat of obscurity and lived a normal, somewhat Mom. Normal life. Yeah. I guess being married, I was married to Genuine at the time, but so I was
normal.
Wasn't
normal about that, I know. Couldn't have been.
See, look, I'm not even going there.
I didn't mean it in a bad way. I meant
the
because...
tone with which you said that.
Okay. Well, probably coming from the daughter of somebody like James Brown.
Right.
So I know it wasn't normal.
It was as normal as I could make it be.
Yeah.
So,
right. Right.
But yeah, I stayed home and I was a stay at home mom and I ended up having another daughter. So I have four daughters and then I started businesses. I went to school. I did a whole lot of things.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
So from at that point when you kind of felt, you know, a shift spiritually and then, of course, you got married. How did that affect, as you're still going through that process, how do you think it affected your marriage? Because now, you know, you guys are clearly divorced. Do you think it affected the relationship that you were growing in a particular way and maybe he wasn't or didn't have an understanding of it?
Of course it affected it, but it actually had a positive effect.
Okay.
At the time because it was a time that he needed and was searching for some things too. So it was a... it was a grounding and normalcy that he could come to and have, you know, something to kind of lean on, you know. When so, yeah, it did, but it wasn't a negative.
So, yeah.
That's good.
Yeah.
Yeah, because sometimes people grow in different directions and it tears the relationship apart. Which,
well, it wasn't from growing in different directions, but I'm not going to get into all of the details
we've read, but, you know, let's
and that may not even be true because I've read a lot of stuff, and I'm like, when did that happen? Because I clearly wasn't there, even though I was.
Speaking of that, how do you feel about that? Because now everything, you know, back when we were doing what we were doing, social media wasn't around and all the blogs. How do you feel about reading things that clearly are not factual?
Normally I don't read them. So when I say I've read things in the past, I used to and had a very long time ago, but it's been a very long, I really don't keep up. So even when like my hype girl and my friends and other people come and be like, oh, the comments on your new video are so good and everybody's loving this and blah, blah, blah. I hadn't read any of them. Then they were like, go respond to some. So I did because I like to make it a habit of really dropping into myself and my essence of who I am and what it is that I'm put here to share. Mm-hmm. And that gets tainted when you start allowing other people's opinions and thoughts and things to come in. So I really don't pay attention. I really don't. So, and that's for the good and the bad because... it's a quote that says the same people that will applaud your coronation will applaud your beheading. So I don't take a whole lot. I appreciate the love. I appreciate those who appreciate and love what I do. And I, you know, I feel it in my heart when people come up to me and say, oh my God, like everything you're doing now is helping me so much. Or you're such an inspiration and all these things. And I really appreciate it. But I still try to stay unattached in a healthy way.
How do you give that message to your children? Because they're of age where they grew up kind of in that and having two famous parents.
But honestly, I kept them. They lived in Brandywine, Maryland in the back. And so, yeah, people knew who we were. But I gave them a really normal as possible life growing up. And they didn't grow up in the limelight. They didn't grow up. Story and Dream didn't even know what their dad did until Dream was probably 8 or 9. She might have been 10. She literally used to walk around and say, I know why people always want to take pictures with daddy, because he's so handsome. Like, this is what she would say. Because she had no clue. I didn't let them watch TV. They obviously didn't listen to his music because it was very sexual, most of it. And yeah, so they didn't have an idea. It was like she saw him on TV on an award, maybe a war show or something, saw him perform it, and she was just like, oh my, like she was blown. She didn't even know.
She had
that's
no idea.
My daddy.
See, that is so, I often say,
I tried to keep them as normal as possible. I wanted them to have survived a really normal, grounded life.
Well, that's awesome, because I couldn't imagine, because I was teased in school because of my dad, so I couldn't imagine when you factor in social media, I probably would have been hanging from a shocker in some place.
See, they're older now. And so, even Story and Dream are 18, and Story just turned 18, and Dream just turned 16. Mm-hmm. And so, Dejan and Cypress, who you know because they were hanging out with us on the road back then, they're in their 20s now. Yeah. Dejan is married.
Yeah.
And so, because they had this really solid grounding, and I kept them not isolated, but I protected them, and I kept this shield of protection around them because I really wanted them to be normal.
Yeah.
And even though, I mean, people look at my life and our life and the things we do, and they're like, y'all are not normal, but in a good way.
Yeah.
But they also, they went to private school, and then they went to like Montessori and Sudbury School, which is totally unschooling, and now they're homeschooled, and they've been homeschooled for a long time, so they really haven't
had to
experience a lot of the stuff that comes along with the world we live in today.
It's horrible.
Yeah, it is. So, I couldn't imagine growing up now.
How do you feel like your music is completely different? So what prompted you to get back into doing music, what you do, you know, best, and that messaging, the kind of music is completely different.
I think one, when something's in you and you have this gifting, or as well as just the desire to create in many ways, because I create in a lot of different ways, but it never goes away. And even though I thought it had, when I left the music industry, I had no desire, intention to ever do music again in any form or fashion. I walked completely away and was like, I don't want anything to do with it. And I came from a musical family. My mother sang with Bloodstone, and my mother was a gospel singer. And so everybody in my family, so one of my cousins is in Sounds of Blackness. Andrea Tribbett is my blood cousin. And so I come from music, and it's just there. And even though I thought it wouldn't, that desire to create in that way started coming back. But it was at a time the industry was really changing. Like, it was switching over from analog to digital. It was everything was online. And I'm like, oh, wait, hold on. And then you get it older in the industry. You're like, okay, wait a minute. How do I don't even know how to navigate this. I don't even know what I would do if I wanted to get back in. But then, you know, something spoke from the inside of me saying, you have a duty and responsibility to not let that one album that does not represent who you are now, that I've had the blessing, the privilege to travel all over the world, to sit at the feet of teachers, of elders, of gurus, to take immersions and trainings, and have all these spiritual awakenings and all these beautiful things in my life that I teach, that I share on a lot of different levels, but I had a duty and responsibility to come back and share that through music and show that evolution through music, and then also not feel any pressure that I have to conform in any type of way to any standard, to what's going on in music now, whatever, because it's not like I'm coming out doing this because I'm strapped for cash. Like, I got to go make a, well, I wouldn't be doing that at 45. Like, it's a lot of other things that I would do. I mean, and I have other businesses and I have other things that I do and that earn money. So this isn't a, it's beautiful to be rewarded monetarily. It's just a form of energy exchange mm-hmm. for what you love to do and for music. But that wasn't the reason to do it. So the reason is just because there's something inside of me that has that desire to create, to offer, to share in that way. And I finally evolved to a space that I felt like I was ready mm-hmm. to share it, that I had matured enough in my spirituality. I had matured enough as a woman to share this and to be able to uplift other people that maybe like my inbox stays full of women. I'm lost. I don't know what to do. I don't know. The ones that I can check, a lot of them I don't see. Someone else will check them and like, oh my gosh, a whole bunch of things in here. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times I just don't have time to get to them and answer, but it's through this music and through my teachings, through my classes and workshops and those offerings, I do get an opportunity to share and touch people in the way that that I feel like is very beneficial and very authentic to me and
needed.
To who I am. Yeah.
It's definitely needed in this. Yeah. How do you, because it's just so noisy and negative and
very noisy.
And
a lot of idle chatter.
Yeah. It's a lot. And see, the thing about it is you're great at ignoring it. But some of the stuff online blows me. And it's not even about me. I'm like, what?
This one right here with her notifications.
Oh my God.
For everything.
See, because of what you do in radio and you have to be privy to what's going on. I don't. So half the time, it was years that I stopped watching news. I was a news junkie. Like, I was a kid, and I wanted to watch the news morning and night. Had to know what was going on because we had to watch the news, and there was no internet.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I don't care. I do a really good job of protecting my energy, and so I don't have to. And so if it doesn't really involve me, I'm good at minding my business. And I mind my business a lot. And so sometimes I'll see things that'll happen to come across, but most of the things I follow, the pages I follow, yeah, I miss a lot of the stuff that everybody else is talking about what's going on, and I'm like, I don't even know who that is, and two, I definitely don't know what you're talking. I mean, yeah, I really don't.
I just think that it reflects, which is a scary thought when you think of it in a different way, other than this person said something bad, and it's. People are really hurting. Mm-hmm. Like, it's really, mm-hmm. really negative. And I mm-hmm. wonder, has it always been like that? And we're just able to see it at this point because, you know, everybody got an opinion from the peanut gallery and they want to put it on, you know, on IG or on Facebook. And like I said, like a lot of them I don't read, and most of them are not necessarily even about me, but it's just to attack another human being in the way that I see, mm-hmm. especially women,
yeah.
one another, blows my mind. And I never knew that kind of negative energy was as vast
yeah.
as it is. And I was like, this just has to be pain. Talk, because there's just no reason for you to get online and say that about somebody you never met. Like, I don't get it.
Like, and also, too, I feel like people don't feel the consequences.
If they come on my page.
Yeah, they don't feel the consequences. They don't think there's any consequences.
Yeah.
Everybody has a phone nowadays, and so they just walking around with their opinions extended from their hand, and they just can say whatever they want. And nobody will know who they are.
It's a disconnect. And so mm-hmm. we call it the disease of disconnection. And so I think that there's some of it is there has always been this amount of pain, of hurt, of some is mental illness, mm-hmm. which the internet and social media exacerbates and has caused a increase in depression and a rise in mental illness, mm-hmm. and we get to see the vastness of it now because everybody does have a platform.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't. And it also has fostered even more disconnection. So in the West, we're already disconnected from one another and from what our ancestors did, which lived as tribal people.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We lived in small community, and we had the support of each other in the community, and we had. We communed with each other, not just online, not just on the phone, but we circled together, especially as women.
Mm-hmm.
And in the West, that is not something that is fostered. It's all about self. How can I get my own place, move out? You know, people don't live together generationally like they do. Even still in old world Europe, they still do that. Mm-hmm. You go and it's the grandparents, the parents, the children. People are living in community. And in the West, it's all about what can I get? We put our elderly in homes. Mm-hmm. We don't, when the grandchildren are supposed to be the home for the parents at some point. You know what I mean? It's not... So we don't have any value for our elders. We don't have any value for community. It's all about self. So that's that disconnect there. It's all about what can I get? How can I get? And you can't, it's difficult to harm someone that you have a close connection with. That's why even if somebody's trying to harm you, they always say, talk about yourself. If somebody's trying to murder you or you know what I'm saying, or trying to attack you, harm you, talk about your children. Make a personal connection, because when you connect with someone personally, it's difficult to harm them. And so this disease of disconnection causes people to be able to do that, to come on, because I have no connection. But when you understand that we're all interconnected and everything I do affects you and everything you do affects me, because we're all interconnected, we're like a ecosystem, a diverse ecosystem working together, and we all affect each other, but we don't understand that. Paramahansa Yogananda said, when you offered me poison, you didn't realize my life was one with your own. So when we're offering poison to someone else, we are inadvertently poisoning ourselves and don't even realize it. So it's this constant cycle of sickness, of disconnection, of poison that we're spewing out. And it is what the internet is a representation of the collective consciousness right now, especially in the West, but that has permeated throughout the rest of the world because the West influences the rest of the world. So it's really sad. And so we as women need to take our place again, our rightful place as the mother, as being venerated as the mother goddess, as the creatrix of everything. But we out at the club.
Trying to be grandparents at 30 years old. You know what I mean?
But, that's crazy. And it's a lot more in deep that we won't have time to go into here on this platform.
What we're gonna do is we're gonna take just a quick little break, and we're gonna go out with your first song that we're gonna play today, The Formula by Soleil, so you guys can hear some of her new music. Make sure y'all call in on 404-418-5233, and we'll be back in a moment. We're back on Soul Sisters. All right, I know that's right. That was great. I was trying to listen to the lyrics while y'all were talking. Teach you how to love. I mean, so many people don't love themselves in this day and age. They can't love other people because they don't love themselves.
Exactly.
I love your energy. Thanks. It's refreshing. Yes. I can definitely say that. It's refreshing. And I'm so glad that you're just teaching us a little bit in here, schooling us and showing us that we can still be disconnected from this mess we see every day and still live in it, I guess.
Having 1 foot on earth and your feet firmly planted on the earth and your head in the clouds and the heavens and the cosmos.
Right.
So being that conduit, a straw, a vessel from spirit, from heaven, from the cosmos, whatever you choose to call it, to earth, and just being an empty vessel so you can be spoken instead of speaking.
Right.
Be spoken.
So you were saying that you're doing, obviously you have new music, and we appreciate that because anytime we can get good music, we're happy about that. But tell us about some of the other things that you're doing, some of the teachings.
Every time somebody asks me that, I'm like, okay, let me pull my bio up in my head, because it's everybody's like, oh my God, you got so much stuff in this bio. So I'm a Jiva Mukti yoga teacher. So I trained in India, in Mumbai. Hmm. And so I teach yoga, traditional Indian form of style of yoga. And I'm a 250-hour certified mystical dance teacher. And so that's using dance as communion with the divine, but in a mystical format. So I teach mystical dance. I'm a doula, a birth doula. I'm not taking clients right now, so Because I had to be on call. So I did. I attended a birth in December. It was the last baby that I got to assist being birthed into this earth realm on December 12th. And but I have to be on call. So I'm not doing any doula work serving in that way right now. I'm also I'm a tantric yogini. So I teach. I don't teach a lot of tantra. I still consider myself. And I, when I'm talking about tantra, I'm not talking about what we think about in the West as tantra, because everybody hears tantra and you automatically think sex and sexual practices. And there is a sexual aspect to tantra if you choose to use that part of it. But tantra is so much broader than that. Mm-hmm. And so my tantra guru, who lives in Malaysia, but he's Tamil, is very traditional tantra. So it's mantra, yantra. It's really sound healing through. Healing through sound.
Okay.
It's called Paratan Inashakti Yoga, which is a form of clearing the human biofield with sound and mantra. So I do that. I'm a prenatal yoga teacher. But I'm a clinical herbalist.
Okay.
So, I train clinical herbalists, and I have a black belt in kung fu. I've been studying martial arts since I was a kid. So I have a I have a martial arts school in Maryland called Dragon Academy of Martial Arts. And obviously, I moved back to Atlanta, so I'm not teaching there. I teach workshops sometime. I just taught a mystical dance workshop there a few weeks ago. But I have a business partner who teaches. We teach Tian Shin Pai is a style of Northern Chinese style of martial arts that we teach there. And what else? I don't know. What else is in my box?
That's a lot.
That's a lot.
It's more, but I'm like, I don't know. What else do I do? A lot of it is healing arts. I'm a Reiki master. I don't like saying master, though. I just hate saying that. It's the title that I have, but usually I'm a Reiki practitioner. And I'm studying sound, more sound therapy, and using the crystal bowls and really working with sound in that way.
All right.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
So you go to my website to see whatever else it is that I'm doing. Because
I have to come take your yoga class.
Yeah, I was teaching not too far up the street and in the west, near the West End, a weekly class there. Yasira Hotep has a comedic yoga school. But because I started doing new music, I couldn't continue my weekly class. So I do workshops.
Okay, I'll have to come to a workshop.
Yes.
So you named some, let us know some of the, I guess, beautiful places that you've been and how it has impacted you spiritually, because you've named some places that are incredible that I dream about going.
I know you were talking about Thailand for
I just got back from Thailand. I was in Koh Phangan with my two younger children for 6 weeks, studying mystical dance with Monica Nataraj, and so I dragged my kids all over the world to do things like that. We stayed in an ashram in India for a few years ago for about a month and a half, and I've been to Ethiopia. My family, my roots go back to Ethiopia and to West Africa and to South India, Tamil, on my mother's side. So a lot of these places I go, I'm connecting back home. Mm-hmm. And so I've spent time in Ethiopia, Cambodia, at the temples in Cambodia. I mean, I've been traveling all over the world since I was probably in my 20s, I started. But now it's spending more time and not just traveling as my 20s and early 30s, I was traveling as a tourist. You know, and enjoying the culture. But the past probably 8 or 9 years or more, I've been traveling as a student and really sitting at the feet of some amazing teachers.
So you talk about basically your ancestry, you know, goes back to these particular places. Do you think that for our community that would contribute in a positive way if we all had the ability, or we do have the ability, to actually go back and visit and know where we actually came from and visit those places and know their practices and know their religions and to really, really be knowledgeable and experience that, how it would, you know, uplift us in our present life? Because most of us don't do it and may never, not even think to do it, and may never have an opportunity to do it.
Yeah, I mean, when Africans were brought here, when our ancestors were brought here and put in servitude, we were stripped of everything. So we were stripped of our names, of our culture, of our religion, of our mother tongue, and were forced into a way of life that was not natural to us. And so we see that manifest. And, you know, Khalid Muhammad said the way that we act, many of us have lost our minds in addition to all the other things that we lost. And so we see that. And that disconnect, that disease of disconnection is even more prevalent. Well, I shouldn't say it's more prevalent, but it is. It seems like it's with the advent of social media and these things that cause us to be even less secure in who we are, and knowing who we are is causing even more PTSD and trauma. And those changes have happened on a cellular level. So we know, and science has confirmed, that the trauma that our ancestors went through the transatlantic slave trade literally altered their DNA, which in turn alters the DNA of all of us that have passed and come through them. And so we have to heal those wounds, and they have to be healed on a cellular level. And there are ways to do that, connecting back to our own cultures and heritage. And even if you don't know, connecting back to a culture that calls you, because we still have these lineages that we have this remembrance deep down on the inside of us. Even if we don't know, we know. I didn't know my connection to some of these other roots. Once I found out later, I always had a draw and a calling. So I was in Ethiopia before I even knew that my family's history went back to Ethiopia. And I was there. I had this deep draw there, as well as to Tamil Nadu, to South India. And so... And to voodoo and the practices of the Yoruba practices, the practices of venerating ancestors and the Orisha. And those things always call me, even as a little child. Even if you don't know, you know. Mm-hmm. We all have that remembrance down in where our true essence is. Mm-hmm. And so we drop out of our thinking mind sometime and get quiet. It's so much chatter. It's always something going on. Most people are never quiet, so you never really get to hear from your true essence. We hear from the chatter in our mind that's been poured in from everything that we're pulling in all day long. But when you get really quiet and drop into that space, then you can actually hear from your true essence, and certain things will call to you. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's very important that we connect back.
Well, I'm jealous, so hopefully one day I'll be able to go to some of these places that I dream about.
You go with me next time.
I would love to.
I'm planning a retreat in Koh Phangan. I fell in love with Thailand. I had spent time in the region before, but I was in Cambodia, so I hadn't been to Thailand yet. And so, when I was there, just got back a few weeks ago. And so, yeah, I'm ready to go back again. So I think I'm going to host a retreat there next year sometime.
So before you go, awesome. We need to switch gears. I'm going to talk about love life, because of course you've been married. So you're married again. So you, of course, we all know who you married, but you got to tell everybody who you married and what made you, I guess, feel, because some people don't want to do it again.
Yeah.
And so what made you, arrive to the space that you were willing and wanting to connect with another human being and get married again in that way?
I love love. And I know that love is probably the most powerful force and healing force on the planet. And even in the scientific level, I'm like super nerd. So somebody's reading scientific studies, as much as I like to be woo-woo esoteric. But even on a cellular level, we show that our bodies are either always in either fight or flight, which is in fear, or in a repair mode, in a mode of regeneration and restore and growth. And love is the strongest force and tool that we can use to be in growth, in repair. And we see that when people fall in love, and they're so, we see that on people. But that's not why. That's not why. That's just a side note. But so I'm married to Professor Griff now from Public Enemy. And I actually have known him since I was 15 years old. We met in 1989.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So it was a new relationship in that way, because we never dated. He didn't like me like that. He liked me as a person, but he is older than me. So I was I was 15, he was in his 20s. And me and my best friend were trying to get a deal. We were we used to open for all the acts. And he was like, how old are you? What are you doing here? Where's your mama?
Where's your mama?
Like, you're going to be in the industry? Yeah, no, I'm going to have to be watching y'all. Me and my best friends. He actually was like a big brother to me. And we just stayed in contact over the years. And as I got married, and he always checked in and how's everybody and blah, blah, blah. And We actually only saw each other a few times over the years of all those years of knowing each other. We bumped into each other at an award show. And when I had my second daughter, I came to Atlanta and visited because he was living here then. And I'm like, look, I got a baby. And, like Uncle Griff holding the baby. And but I always, when people would talk about him, I would always say, I love him. That's my brother. Like, I love, it was I have a picture on my phone of the first time we met and we're hugging. We look like we're going to prom or something, but we look like we had known each other forever because it was a knowing, but I never in a million years thought we would date or let alone get married. And so, 2016, I had been divorced for a year. I had been separated for a couple years, but I had been divorced for a year. And somebody mentioned his name. And I was like, oh, that's my brother. I love him. My God, I wonder what he's doing. I looked. He had sent me an inbox like the year before. Like, oh, just checking on you. How are things? And I was like, oh, shit, I didn't even respond. I can't call this man now. Checking on him after I ignored his message. And but then somebody mentioned his name again like the next month. And I was like, okay, I must need to check on him for some reason. And I did. And he was going through some stuff that too much to talk about on this. But so he was like, I'm gonna fly to Maryland to see you. I haven't seen you in forever. How are you? Blah blah blah. He came up, we went to lunch, talked for 3 hours, and then a few days later we went, he came to I invited him to a martial arts competition that we were at. And then we went for tea, and I was like, you got to meet my children. He had never met my younger two children, and we met. And then after that, we posted a picture, and everybody was like, oh, man. Like, everybody saw it, what we didn't see. Mm-hmm. But then we kind of, something changed after that tea that was like, okay, he's kind of not my brother no more. But I mean, I had a crush on him when I was 15, but that went away. You know, yeah. It's like, who you got a crush? Yeah. I had a crush on Michael Jackson, too, when I was 15, and now it's a barge. And, you know, it wasn't like, oh, I'm going to be with him. So, but it just worked. He called me and said, after that tea, he said, I'm going to fly back to take you on a date. And we went on a date, and within that first month, we knew we were going to get married. And we didn't tell anybody, but we started walking this path for a year of walking four seasons together. Mm-hmm. And then going through all of the seasons of winter, summer, spring, and fall, and symbolic of the things that happen in a relationship. And then we, almost a year to the date that we went on our first date, we got married.
Oh, yeah. That's an awesome story.
That's a great story.
That's the short of it.
Yeah. That is an awesome story. Well, let me tell you something. It's been so good seeing you again, just it's off so the rip, just because I haven't seen you. But
you're still dancing?
Like, no, I'm singing. I have a band.
You would come do some shows, but
No, I just sing and choreograph. I'm old.
I know,
I'm like,
right.
I gotta do what? No, I'm not gonna do that. So, but just your energy and your teachings and your message has been, it's been wonderful. And just to see the growth in you and just see what you've done with your life is really, really impressive. And I hope people really take heed as far as blocking out the noise and a lot of things that you just don't pay attention to and being able to propel your life forward in a way that's positive and uplifting for others and fulfilling for you and your family.
That's a goal. So my goal is always to walk into a space and leave it more beautiful than I found it. And that every teaching and everything I do is dedicated to the upliftment of the consciousness of humanity to a frequency of love. And so that's my goal now in everything
I do. Y'all hear
that?
Please.
So, I might fall short if I'm driving and you like cut me off and I might cuss out in my head and I'll be like, dang, that was not okay. Because as much as I try, I'm not perfect.
Yeah.
So sometimes I'm like, dang.
But just the fact that the thing is that you know, you're aware. I think a lot of people have no awareness of it.
No, I practice it.
And so
I do
that's
practice.
That's something you have to practice. So, well, thank you so much.
Practice.
And y'all, make sure you check out our music. Make sure you let everybody know where they can find everything that you're doing.
Everything. So the music is all on all the major streaming platforms. Pranayama was the first single I dropped, and The Formula is next. And I'm dropping Under the Veil next month, which I just shot that video in Thailand. And but if you come, my Instagram is Mrs. Soleil, MRSSOLE. And so the link in my bio has everything. Link to my website, to my wellness website, to all of the workshops and teachings and classes and performances that I have coming up. So, yeah.
Well, congratulations thank you for hanging with us.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for hanging with us. So we're going to go out with another song. Now, this one's
Pranayama.
Pranayama.
Okay.
Well, the short of it is,
y'all, your name's in it a little bit.
A little bit.
You're watching Soul Sisters on Pure Soul, powered by Isaac Hayes on Dash Radio.